immediately before the event, they approached the victim sitting at the podium, and they were taking the pictures from the close-up, but really in front of their face, you know. So this was just, you know, to show them that they are more powerful and we can do anything to your, I don't know, relatives or families, you know, back in the north.
That conversation is coming up in just a moment. From Asia News Weekly, you're listening to Asia Now, a collection of stories and interviews from the Asia Pacific region. The United Nations is currently taking up the issue of human rights abuses in North Korea. What's the big deal? And why are some trying to refer the matter to the International Criminal Court? It's just one conversation taking place in Asia now. Welcome everyone to this week's Asia Now podcast. I'm your host, Steve Miller. And I'd like to thank you for taking a moment to listening and downloading this week's podcast. Michael Kirby, a former Australian judge, led the United Nations Commission of Inquiry on North Korea's alleged human rights violations. In February, that commission produced a 372-page report. It detailed wide-ranging abuses, including prison camps, systematic torture, starvation, and killings comparable to Nazi-era atrocities. The report's publication prompted calls among Western states and their allies for punitive action to be taken against North Korea. A draft resolution, prepared for the Third Committee by the European Union and Japan, urges that the General Assembly send the regime to the International Criminal Court in The Hague to stand trial for crimes against humanity. It's the first time a measure this strong has ever been requested. Quote, "The United Nations is about to meet a moment of truth," said Kirby. He continues, "The essential question will be whether the United Nations will stay the course and adhere to making the principle of accountability of great crimes a reality." North Korea responded by releasing its own account of its human rights record and launching what many are calling a charm offensive. Joining me now via Skype is Joanna Hosniak, Deputy Director General of the Citizens Alliance for North Korea Human Rights, to discuss the DPRK, its human rights status, and the matter currently before the United Nations. Joanna, welcome to the podcast.
Thank you very much for having me.
Now, over the years, there have been numerous reports on the status of human rights within North Korea. What makes this most recent report different? And if you could also explain, what was your role in helping to create it?
You know, it's UN independent report, so it's different in a sense that so far, for so many years or decades even, many NGOs were preparing their own reports. But these reports were often discredited, you know, as not being balanced and so on. So we really needed a comprehensive report from the UN, from the independent experts that would look into all of the matters altogether. And some people would say, well, but you had a special rapporteur since 2004, and he was also presenting the reports. Well, but the reports were very short. These were usually the updates of what has been happening, what were the new developments. So he didn't have enough time to look into the matters of North Korean human rights violations from the beginning of the, you know, of the creation of North Korean state, because it lasts for many decades, and look at the patterns and really write about it. And that's what happened with the UN Commission of Inquiry report. And as for the question of, you know, how we contributed to the creation, well, at certain point we've realized, because my NGO, NKHR, that is a short form of Citizens Alliance for North Korean Human Rights, was going to Geneva every year since 2002. And we realized that such countries as, for example, Sri Lanka or Syria, obviously get a lot of attention because it's visible, because it's, you know, out there in media, and North Korea is not. So even though we were bringing the victims and it really changed somehow the, you know, the atmosphere in Geneva, it was still not enough. And then we realized that we really need to engage the higher UN officials. And so what we did was that in December of 2012, we went with two North Korean victims to meet with UN High Commissioner for Human Rights, then Navi Pillai. Now we have a new one, but it was Navi Pillai. And she met with us and with those two victims. It was first time for her to meet with North Korean victims, despite the fact that, you know, UN was targeting North Korea in its human rights resolution for almost 10 years at that time. And it was first time for her to meet with a South Korean NGO working on that issue. And we requested her to use her office to create something, you know, bigger, to do something more on North Korean human rights. And soon after, the meeting was great. And soon after that meeting, she issued a statement that she thinks that the UN Commission of Inquiry should be established. And for us, that was, you know, like a certificate that we could go around, lobby different governments, meet with them individually and convince them that there should be a Commission of Inquiry created. There was a lot of problems in the beginning and obstacles because, you know, many states thought we have a special rapporteur. Why do we need commission and so on? We really needed to step up our advocacy efforts to convince the states. And once the resolution was, you know, the text was input into the resolution, what happened was that the UN Human Rights Council didn't even vote. It passed by consensus. And this is how the commission was created. We also had NGOs could have input also into who, what kind of candidates they wanted to see at the commission. The decision was taken, of course, by the UN and by the president of the council. But everyone, you know, all the stakeholders concerned, including the states, could submit the candidates.
That certainly is a long number and very complicated series of steps that you had to follow to get where you are now. And the end result is a very, very comprehensive and detailed report.
Yeah, that's true. I mean, you know, that's why we wanted to have the commission, because we knew that there will be, you know, in terms of special rapporteur, he's alone and he has part-time staff. You are not able to create this kind of report having this kind of resources. We knew it would be costly, but then if you have, for example, 10 or 15 people working on that, you really can pull it off in a very short time, and that's what it happened. And of course, as for the you know, last stage of the report, NGOs also could have its input. There were several meetings, both official and unofficial, and the commissioners were doing the decision by their own and the commission itself, you know. But for example, NGOs could have certain recommendations. And one of our concerns, for example, was we wanted rather that there will be a reference to special tribunal for North Korea, and because ICC is limiting, we can talk about that later. We also, you know, thought that if there is UN office created, it should be somehow a way of an archive, and that the process of, for example, transitional justice, like was in South Africa, like truth commissions and including South Korea, is not relevant to that case. So we strongly, you know, voiced that out during the meetings, and it was somehow reflected in some of the recommendations of the commission. So, you know, NGOs always have input on many stages. They cannot really write the report or you know, have effect on the final outcome, but they can have some suggestions. But also, as for the creation, I think this was the great success of civil society working on this issue for so long.
Once this report was made public, North Korea then took it upon themselves to do their, quote, own research, and they released their own report on their human rights record that certainly painted a more rosy picture. And I wanted to get your thoughts on that. Was there anything in their report that you thought was interesting, whether from a standpoint of what they omitted or things that they included in the report?
Well, I would say that they would omit everything that was, you know, very important. I wouldn't call it even human rights report. It's somehow advertisement of the unique political ideological system, you know. So the fact that they tried to create something like that, well, I don't know. Some people feel that this is important stamp. For me, it's funny. I mean, they have been preparing human rights report before because, you know, when you look into, for example, universal periodic review process that they went through both this year and 4 years ago, they always have to create this kind of human rights report. And if you look at them, they are much more in detail as than this human rights report that they publish separately. But they are also very rosy. For example, I can tell you that recently they stated that they have admit that they have problems with medical assistance in the province, but because they have state-of-the-art internet and technological internet connections and technological development, the medical personnel in Pyongyang can assist through internet the surgeries with the doctors in provinces, and you just cannot, you know, laugh knowing that there is only 2 hours of electricity in the state, and sometimes people die on the surgical table because, you know, they were during the surgery when the cut-off happened. So they do put sometimes this bizarre, you know, information into their reports, but somehow this is sometimes very irrelevant. Like, for example, they are bragging about, I don't know, making a ski resort and how it improves, you know, the life of the people. I wouldn't, you know, look into that as something very much important. The only thing that matters here, why they did it, is that they did it in order to step up contra, you know, campaign against the report of Commission of Inquiry. And I think we have to look at this as such. This was just a first step to kind of, you know, create this whole charm offensive that they are using right now. And there was a report just a few hours ago that they met with special rapporteur and then that invited them into the country. So this is just another step that they are trying to dismiss the Commission of Inquiry report and also to try to convince as many countries, especially in the global south, not to vote for the resolution of human rights, especially that will have the clause of the referral to International Criminal Court. So it has nothing really to do with the human rights situation. It's not really a substantial report. It has to do with the strategy of how to abolish these efforts that have started with the Commission of Inquiry and how to stop this process.
Joanna, you've actually just returned from New York, from the United Nations, and were on hand when North Korea appeared and made for some, well, let's just say it, some very dramatic situations when this report was being discussed. Can you please set the stage for us and tell us what happened?
We have co-organized that meeting with other international NGOs. We partnered closely, especially with Human Rights Watch. And there were two others, JBI and US Committee. And we also, you know, reach out to different missions to co-sponsor that event. And so this was event created. The main sponsorship came from the States in cooperation with NGOs. That's how it is done in New York. And then we would bring the victims and interpreters for the event and some visual material, the drawings of the victims to be displayed in the room. So yes, I was there at the meeting when they came.
And what happened?
First of all, they tried to intimidate the victims that were there because immediately before the event, they approached the victims sitting at the podium and they were taking the pictures from the close-up, but really in front of their face, you know. So this was just, you know, to show them that they are more powerful and we can do anything to your, I don't know, relatives or families, you know, back in the north. Secondly, there were several people discussing at the panel, including ambassadors of Australia, you know, Botswana and Panama, and of course, Justice Kirby, former chair of the UN Commission of Inquiry. You could see that they were making some kind of comments. You know, I was in the back, so I didn't hear about everything. But you could tell that they are making fun sometimes, that they are discussing something, and you know that they are kind of showing that you know that they are over it. kind of, they are better than that. Third, you know, they started to make their own comments, and these comments were, of course, not unusual. This is something that they did for many, many years. The comments that, you know, the Commission of Inquiry was manipulated, that victims were manipulated, that investigation and that questions to the victims were leading, you know, from the commissioners and et cetera, et cetera. It goes on, and, you know, it's a standard copy-paste response that they usually have. What was unique about it was that they started to ask questions directly to Justice Kirby. It has never happened before. So they asked him several questions. And the most important questions was, on what grounds they judged that there were crimes against humanity, and how can they prove that this was policy of the state? So you can tell that this is what really bothers them. And of course, the meeting itself, you know, the fact that this was meetings that we also do in Geneva. In Geneva, the events can also be done only by NGOs, not necessarily with cooperation with the state, but they would never show up to these meetings. And now they would come to this kind of parallel event, you know, at the UN. But you can really tell that the only thing that really bothers them right now is the fact that Commission, you know, found that there are reasonable grounds that crimes against humanity were committed in all nine areas, and that the country should be referred either to ICC or that there should be a special tribunal created, because that is in the recommendation. In the resolution, it's only referral to ICC, because these days in our legal system is the easiest version. Since we have criminal court created, the states think that it's easier way to just refer country to ICC.
The measure is now going to be sent to the General Assembly to be voted on to refer North Korea to the International Criminal Court to stand trial for crimes against humanity. And of course, ultimately, that does need to go to the Security Council for a binding resolution. But I wanted to ask you, what does this mean for North Korea, especially since we're all assuming that China is going to veto the measure?
And that's the problem, because we, of course, know there is China and Russia, but China is here the most important, and we know that it would veto. And we knew that from the beginning. So it's not, you know, it's not that NGO strategy failed because, you know, they used something like that. No, it was, you know, carefully thought out strategy from the beginning. We knew that there would be veto from China. There are many other options that can be done, that Security Council can do. So it's not only referral to ICC. There are certain sanctions, and I'm not talking here about economic sanctions, but sanctions against the leadership. Something that was done, for example, against Putin and his group, or against you know, Gaddafi. And there are certain sanctions that could be done against those that are responsible for crimes. The countries also could use their own domestic jurisdictions into, for example, arresting someone when traveling. Something that was done also in the past in the UK, for example. So there are many, many different, you know, avenues that this could develop. And also, you know, we could look into how General Assembly itself could act if Security Council is unable to act. This is a long-term strategy, though. And one thing that, you know, North Korea does not realize is that responsibility for crimes is non-negotiable. You know, this is where this whole thing goes into, because they would very much like to take out this language of the referral from the resolution. And for that, they stepped up these efforts. And that's why they appeared at the October 22nd meeting. Now met with Marzuki Darosman, special rapporteur, and invited him to the country. And it was yesterday. And this is only part of the effort. Probably there will be even more. The thing is that, you know, what can you do out of that? I mean, even if the special rapporteur goes into the country, or even high commissioner goes into the country, what they can really see? What will they be shown, you know, there? It's nothing that they can really they cannot make the independent investigation there. They will not have ad hoc access to any areas or ad hoc access to people. And that would be even dangerous to people to interview them there. So I think North Korea does not realize that even with this effort, without undertaking a real reforms on the grounds, they will not be able to stop this motion, because the special rapporteur will not be able to create a rosy report suddenly that, you know, he was wrong. That is not the case with North Korea. So they don't realize that with these efforts, they are only postponing. They are, you know, appealing to many countries in Southeast Asia and Africa. And of course, it may work to a certain extent, but this strategy will probably backfire in 1 year or 2 years, when international community realizes that it was only to show off, you know, certain engagement, but these are only words and no actions that follow after that.
Joanna, I wonder if we could take a step back and look at North Korea in terms of a broader perspective. And if we look at a large scale of time, I wanted to get your opinion on the current trend of human rights in North Korea. Are we seeing a change? Are we seeing an increase in the quality of life in North Korea? Or are we seeing a decline?
I think since Kim Jong-un took power, the things are really deteriorating in North Korea. And it is both, you know, we could see that both at the top leadership, right, at the executions and so on, the change of power. But you can only imagine, you know, what it is like for normal people, the increase of control. And we know, you know, that as being in the network of these NGOs that also have access to China, that it is very difficult for people to leave the country, increasingly difficult, and the punishments are increasing. This only means that, you know, the control in the country is being, stepped up. And also in terms of political prison camps, there are reports that, you know, in the past we had at least two camps from which prisoners could be released. Right now it seems that some of dismantled, but only in order to kind of move them to areas, you know, new areas where it will be difficult to check, and that prison camps are now total control zone camps, which means that prisoners will not be released from there unless somebody escapes. We will have less and less testimonies from the camps. And that's what they are doing. Then they've realized that, you know, of course they deny the existence of the political prison camps, concentration camps, these death camps, but they are also afraid that, you know, because there were so many witnesses, and they were giving evidence, and the evidence was cross-checked with satellite photo images and so on, and now they are trying to relocate the camps, change the system in order so that nobody will be ever released from those camps. So you can tell that despite the efforts internationally, what they are trying to do, internal situation is even getting worse.
Joanna, just one final question. There are a lot of people out there that think of North Korea as a very small, troublesome nation, that Kim Jong-un just likes to rattle his sabers and cause problems for his neighbors, and that the world would be better off just leaving North Korea alone and allow it to collapse upon itself. Taking this issue of human rights to a global stage, why is it important to care about what happens within the borders of the DPRK?
Well, I think that it doesn't matter what size our country is. We've saw in the history that even small countries can create a lot of problems for other states. So, first of all, you know, North Korea is not fully independent country. If it was, you know, if it had enough resources and so on, then maybe it can survive and, you know, do what it wants to do internally and we don't have to bother because it doesn't have an effect on their neighboring countries. Unfortunately, North Korea is not like that. It's an incredibly impoverished country, and whatever happens inside will have effect on, you know, push effect on people, and that push effect will have also, you know, effect on neighboring countries. So that is one thing we have to look into. Secondly, you know, there is a link, and this is the most important, I guess, that there is a link between human rights and threat to peace. And that's what we see with these countries that, you know, are totalitarian countries, countries that also might be in possession of nuclear weapons and so on, that we really don't know if you know, if there are no reforms being taken into the country and country does not democratize, anything can happen in that country. Any internal conflict could have also potential disastrous effect on South Korea or on China. So, for example, you have, I don't know, some military personnel increasing in power and they take over certain regions and they start to fight. They have access to, I don't know, some nuclear weapons. I mean, anything can happen, and you just have to realize that you know, if the country commits so many human rights violations and does not make any economic reforms, then the neighboring countries will always have problem with that country. We just have to force North Korea somehow on the right path. And because engagement works only to a certain extent with North Korea, they are only responding to pressure, then, you know, human rights is also one of the, we started to use pressure in our human rights work as well. Because that has, you know, that had had good effect also on other countries in the past when the countries were so powerfully, you know, pushed by international community. And for example, the referral to ICC or any potential, you know, referral to criminal justice in different form is always somehow a wake-up call. Not in all cases, but in many cases, it is a potential wake-up call for the regime because they start to think what will happen to us and our family, just in case, you know. So I think we have to care about what's going on in North Korea in order for that country to start to think and start to undertake some meaningful reforms on the ground.
Joanna Hosnack, Deputy Director General for the Citizens Alliance for North Korea Human Rights, thank you very much for joining me this week.
Thank you very much.
Now it's time to hear from you. Are North Korean human rights violations a matter of importance for the world? If the call to refer the regime to the International Criminal Court fails to go through, does that mean the United Nations is useless and this was all for naught? Please share your thoughts in the comments on Facebook or Twitter. And if you haven't found us on social media, you can find us at facebook.com/AsianNewsWeekly or at AsianNewsWeekly on Twitter. You can even shoot us an email with your questions, feedback, or even audio comments about this show. That email address is AsianNewsWeekly@gmail.com. You can, of course, download and play every single episode at our website, AsianNewsWeekly.net. But if you love the show in podcast form, you can find us on Stitcher, iTunes, and TuneIn Radio. And if you especially enjoyed this week's episode, please subscribe and share it with your friends. Well, my friends, that is it for this week. I want to thank you so much for listening. And until next time, for Asia Now, I'm Steve Miller. Asia Now is licensed under a Creative Commons Attribution 4.0 international license.